Good morning. Welcome, welcome to Crossville Baptist Church. I do not have a bulletin, so I'm going to wing it here this morning. Hopefully I remember everything, but pull out your bulletins and you should see on the very front, you should see on the very front of it is Kidsalt. So that is tomorrow. Be praying for us. There's 14 of us that will be going. Be praying for the kids the children this week as they go off to camp. It's just like what I was telling you about with Somersault. It's the exact same thing, but on a children's level. So we are praying that God will do mighty things with these during this week, and it will really impact our kids' lives. Be praying for that. And the next thing is Surge Trampoline Park is the 16th for our youth. And then also Frankie's Fun Park is the 20th for our youth. But I wanted to mention that only because rising sixth graders, it is not too far away where you'll be an official youth. It will be the first week of August. So if you are in the going to be going into the sixth grade, you are more than welcome to join in on the fun during the summer as well. So be thinking about that, and you can join in on that. Also, we bringing Wednesday nights back this week, so you look forward to that. Charles has been doing a fantastic study on Wednesday nights. Miss Barbara's been leading it as well, but Pastor Charles will be back this Wednesday, so you can come and enjoy that with him. He's been doing a great study with that. Youth, we are back full swing on Wednesday nights as well. Children, you will be at Kids Salt. There still will be a Wednesday night as well for those of you who are not going to camp. All right, so you come and be a part of that. Do me a favor, one last thing. When Zane mentions later in the service, stand and greet each other. Do me a favor. Stand and greet each other and like go from this side. And I want you to like people over here, I want you to go over here. Don't just stand there like a little stick in the mud. Get out and move, because this is a very welcoming church. I want you to say it's great to see you here today. God bless you. Have fun with it. But really get to know each other in that little moment, because I do know that there are some new faces in here this morning. I want you to find them and say it's nice to have you here this morning. With all of that said, would you pray with me as we begin today's service? God, thank you so much for today and what that brings. It brings just another day that we can spend time with you. And it brings another day that we can come into your house and just celebrate the things that you have done in our lives. We can reflect back on the things that you have done in our lives and give you all the praise and the glory for the blessings that you have given us. But it's also another day that we can come and just learn more about you. We can never learn enough. So God, I pray, Lord, for Pastor Charles as he's bringing the message this morning, that we learn how to fight and how to be Christians, strong Christians in 2023. May you really resonate in that area this morning, where we can just learn how to be more like you when you are going through the same persecutions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Once I was clothed in the rags of I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, Jesus, when I met you. When you called my name and I ran out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Best part right here. I want y'all to sing it out this morning.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy, but the chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healer. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. Cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. You call my name. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Amen. Give the Lord praise. You may be seated, church.
Good morning. How is everybody this morning? Oh, well, all right. Kiddos, will you come up so we can have our children's message, please? Wonderful, wonderful. How are you guys this morning? Good. Is summer going great? Yes, awesome. I wonder, does anybody like Sprite? You do? Would you like a Sprite? Oh, there it is. Okay. You want Sprite? Okay. even better. Who wants the Sprite now? Would you open it? It's still Sprite. It would be kind of fun. It wouldn't taste the same, but what else would it do? It would explode everywhere, right? It would be all over the place. I can't let you do that because I like my job. But that, a can of soda, so if I were to try to open it now, it would explode because of all the carbonation in there. It's going to just like everywhere. That's kind of like whenever we get angry. How many of you have ever been angry before? I think we all have, right? We've all been angry before. And whenever we're angry, do we make the best decisions? Nope, we don't. We kind of think that everything is about us and we're, right? Kind of like the Hulk, you know? But is it wrong for us to be angry? No. Anger isn't bad, but what happens with our anger is that we lose what's called self-control. There's a verse in the Bible, and it comes from Ephesians, and it says, be angry and do not sin. So in other places, it says, don't let your anger allow you to sin. All right? So anger isn't bad. It's what we do with it. But it does go on to warn us, do not let the sun go down on your anger and give no opportunity to the devil. So what's really hard is, and what even a lot of adults are really bad at this, whenever you're angry, you've got to chill for a second, right? You've got to calm down and use that time to focus on who? On Jesus, on God. God's going to give us the strength to have the self-control to do the thing that we need to do and not to sin. There's a lot of things in the world that are bad and things that can make us angry, but we have to remember that we have to take that anger and calm down and not allow the devil to use it for bad. Sometimes if you get angry about something, it might show you something that needs to change, and you can think, God, how can I take my anger away? How can I make a decision that's going to be best for you? And that anger, sometimes, if we use it the right way, if we have God help us and calm us down, we can use that to do things that are great for God and for the kingdom. But what we have to make sure is that we don't, in that anger, say something that's really mean or do something that's wrong. We have to stop and not take the soda can that's been shaken and open it and have it explode everywhere, right? We have to calm down. All right, let's pray. God, we thank you that you give us this example. God, in our world and things that happen, bad things happen, and there's going to be times where we get upset, Father, but help us to use a calming force through you, Father, to calm down, to not use our anger to explode and go everywhere using words or actions that hurt other people, Father, but help us to focus our hearts on you. Help us to calm down. Father, let us not allow the devil to use that time to allow us to do something wrong. So God, help us to have self-control. Help us to always be a light for you, even in times that are difficult. God, we love you and we praise you. It's your name we pray. Amen.
Almighty fortress is our God. On earth is not striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. You ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is He.
Like Nathan said, cross the room, turn and greet those around you as our choir comes down this morning. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us to worship you, the one true living God. And even in these divisive, turbulent times, dear Lord, we know that if we have our faith anchored in Jesus Christ, that anchor will always hold. We pray, dear Lord, that your Holy Spirit would be present in this service, that it would open our hearts, it would open our minds for the message that your servant is prepared to deliver today. We pray that you would bless, that you would multiply this offering for us. In your precious name we do pray. Amen.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so faithful. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Yeah, 'cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I'm gonna sing, 'cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I'm gonna sing.
Sayla is going into the sixth grade, so aren't one that exciting? That whole family can sing. It's amazing the talent. Well, the mama's hiding out from us. She's not going to do it. But thank you so much, Sayla. That is absolutely one of my favorite contemporary songs. I love it. And I thought, how can that little girl do that big song? But you did it. You nailed it. Thank you so much. That was such a blessing. We have some people I would like for you to pray for this morning. I'd like for you to pray for Dale Hill and his family. He is in hospice house in Florence, and the doctor said that it was only a matter of hours now. So pray for Dale and for Margaret and for the girls and the family as they wait for Dale to enter into eternity. Also, pray for Miss Frances Mims. She fell and broke her hip and had to have surgery yesterday morning, and she's in the hospital here at Toomey. And then if you also pray for one of our older members, pray for Miss Betty Louder. She had to go to from the hospital to National Healthcare, and right now she's not too happy about that. So you just pray for her and pray that things will work out for her also. So if you would, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, today we come very thankful and grateful for your love. So thankful, Lord, for the blessings you give us in life to have friendships and fellowship with one another. And Father, some of our brethren are hurting this morning. Father, there's death approaching Dale very soon. But Lord, we know that he is saved and we know that he is in your hands and you're taking care of him. And Father, Miss Frances has experienced a terrible fall and her hip was very damaged. And we're thankful for the doctor who corrected that and the talents you gave to him to do the surgery. Now we pray, Lord, for her as she heals. And Father, we pray for Miss Betty Louder. She's always been such an active person, Lord. But Father, because of the recent stroke, she has been disabled and had to slow down tremendously. Father, help her to accept her circumstances right now and be willing to continue to fight to get better and that things will continue to improve. And Father, we just trust these to you and others to you, Lord, and the things that are happening in their lives. Now, Lord, help us as we look at fighting fear in our own lives. Father, fear is something that we all experience. It's part of the human nature. But help us, Lord, to see how we can overcome fear through your power. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When I was about 4 or 5 years old, I can't remember exactly how old, but I was very young, and I had my own bedroom because I had 4 sisters, no brothers, so I had my own bedroom. And I heard one night, I was awakened one night with a noise, and the bedroom window, my bed was here, and the bedroom window was over there, and it faced the front porch of the house. So I heard a noise, and I looked over at the window, and I saw a figure in the window. I could see someone at the window. Well, I literally froze with fear. I could not yell for mom or dad. I could not get out of bed. I could not move. I was absolutely frozen in fear. Well, when daylight finally came, I told my parents about it, and Daddy went out and looked, and sure enough, someone had taken the screen off the window and was trying to get in the window, but thankfully, the window was locked. But I can remember that fear like it was today, how I was just frozen in that moment. I know we all face fears in our lives, and some of you even have fears right now. I wonder what some of the fears are in your life. Some that I think we all face from time to time in our lives is the fear of poverty. When I first moved to Alexandria, Virginia, straight out of seminary, making $16,000 a year in one of the most expensive metro areas in the United States, let me tell you, I was afraid at first. I said, I'm not going to be able to make it. But thankfully, I had a church family that loved me and God took care of me, and I had 4 great years in that area. Some people have the fear of criticism. I have a feeling that when Nathan got up here and preached his first sermon, he was probably afraid of the criticism he might get for that sermon. But God took care of him and God blessed him and used him, and he delivered a great message. I remember that first message. And then some of you have the fear of the loss of love. Now, teenagers, you go through this. You fall heavy in love with someone, and then all of a sudden they break up with you, and you're so afraid you're going to lose them and all this. But believe me, life goes on, okay? But some people live in that fear of the loss of love. I know 2 people that never had that fear. They celebrated their 72nd wedding anniversary recently, Sammy and Joanne Jackson. And the reason they never feared of losing each other's love, because when they got married, that's what they did. They got married. And they never thought about not being married to each other. And because of that, they experienced 72 years so far of marriage. They told me this morning that the Carters President Carter and his wife just celebrated 77 years. I said, y'all gonna get there too. We'll be doing that one day with you. But some people fear the loss of love. Then there's always the fear of illness. So many of you in here have had that moment when you found out you had a disease, and it was a fear that gripped you at first. Some of us have the fear of old age. If you don't have the fear of old age, you will one day. It'll catch up with you sooner or later, and things start happening. But that's okay. You deal with it, march on. And then there are people that have the fear of death. I tell people I'm not afraid of death itself. In fact, I'm looking forward to death because that's the entry into heaven. And I'm excited about being with my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for eternity. But what I fear is how I might die. And I'm sure some of you have that fear too. There's two ways I do not want to die. I don't want to die by drowning, and I don't want to die by fire. Those two I'm afraid of big time. But people have that fear. And then there are many people that have the fear of what's happening right now in our country. And I think that's a very real fear that many of us face. So fear is a part of life. But we cannot let fear freeze us in the moment and freeze us from doing what God wants us to do. I want to show you one of the greatest examples of fear in the Bible. It's found in Deuteronomy chapter 1. And I've preached this passage before, but God keeps, over the years, has kept bringing me back to this passage because I think it teaches such an important lesson for us about how to overcome fear and what happens if we do not overcome fear, how it can bring bad things in our lives. In Deuteronomy chapter 1, we're looking at the Israelites. God has taken them, freed them from Egypt. He brought them through the Red Sea, parted the Red Sea for them to cross over. He has provided for them in the wilderness as they have made their journey toward the Promised Land. And now they're on the edge of the Promised Land, waiting to cross over. And God says to them, "Here is my gift to you. Now go and grab it. It's time for you to move in back into the Promised Land that I gave to your forefathers." But we're going to see how fear held them back from following God's plan. He wanted them to have the Promised Land. He intended for them to, but fear overcame them. So let's begin in Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 19. It says, "Then as the Lord our God commanded us, we set out from Horeb and went toward the hill country of the Amorites, through all that vast and dreadful wilderness that you have seen, and so reached Kadesh Barnea. Then I said to you, 'You have reached the hill country of the Amorites, which the Lord of our God is giving us. See, the Lord your God has given you the land. Go up and take possession of it as the Lord the God of your ancestors told you. Do not be afraid, nor to be discouraged.' Then all of you came to me and said, 'Let us send men ahead to spy out the land for us and bring back a report about the route we are to take and the towns we will come to.' The idea seemed good to me, so I selected 12 of you, one man from each tribe." Here we have the account of where they're getting ready to move into the Promised Land, but we see already the seeds of fear being placed in them. They knew God's promise. This had been taught to them since they were born, that they were to go back to the land flowing with milk and honey that God had promised them. It was going to be theirs. Now they had finally made it across the wilderness. They were ready to cross over into the Promised Land, but they say, "Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Let's send some spies over there to check it out first. We're not quite ready to go in there until we know what's over there already." Now, you and I both know that life doesn't always work that way. We cannot always see what is down the road. There has to be faith involved in living the Christian life. We have to let faith guide us and lead us forward in life. The Israelite children here at this point were not willing to step forward until they sent spies out. And the spies brought back a report of the land. So if you'll look in Numbers 13, beginning with verse 26, it says, "They came back to Moses and Aaron and the whole Israelite community at Kadesh in the desert of Paran. There they reported to them and to the whole assembly and showed them the fruit of the land. They gave Moses this account: We went into the land which you sent to us, and it does flow with milk and honey. Here is its fruit, but the people who live there are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large. We even saw descendants of Anak there, and the Amalekites live in the Negev. The Hittites, the Jebusites, and the Amorites live in the hill country, and the Canaanites live near the sea and along the Jordan. So you could see in their report there was fear there. They saw that it was going to be a difficult task, they felt, to move into the promised land. But two of the 12 spies, two of them came back with a positive report. Look in Numbers chapter 14, verse 6. And this is a report given by Joshua and Caleb. It says, Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had explored the land, tore their clothes and said to the entire Israelite assembly, "The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into the land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and will give it to us." Now, I want you to notice the difference here between the report of Joshua and Caleb, and now look what the 10 spies, how they sum up their report in Numbers 13:31. "But the men who had gone up with him said, 'We cannot attack these people. They are stronger than we are.'" So they were giving up before they even tried. They were backing down because of fear. They were afraid to go into the promised land because of the people that already lived there. Joshua and Caleb were not. How did these 12 see it with such different eyes? 10 saw it with fear, 2 saw it with faith. And those 2 were willing to go forward with what God wanted them to do. We can overcome fears in our lives if we march forward in faith. Now, there are some basic principles we can see in this account concerning fear so far. First of all, fear distorts God's plan and his purpose. God has said to the Israelite children, "This is going to be your land. Go and take it." And yet, because of their fear, it distorted God's plan and purpose for them. And they even said they were willing to turn back and go back to Egypt and be slaves in Egypt and die there instead of having to face the giants in the land. Secondly, fear discourages God's people. So many people let fear get them to the point that they just give up on what God wants in their lives. They just give up and settle. Settle for where they are in their walk with him, and they miss out on so much. Unfortunately, the Israelites did this in the promised land. They became discouraged when they saw all the people that already lived in the promised land. They felt like there was no way they would be able to take the land, and they became very discouraged. Third, fear makes us doubt God's promises. They knew the promises of God from the time they were born. They were taught the promises of God. They had experienced God taking care of them as he brought them out of the slavery in Egypt and across the wilderness. And here they were getting ready to enter into the promised land. And yet they started doubting God's promises. Even though God had taken care of them up to this point, they were doubting. And then fourthly, fear can cause us to disobey God. And that's exactly what they were willing to do, to disobey God, to not go forward and take the promised land, but to turn back toward Egypt. And because of that, God brings judgment on them. People, so many Christians miss out on God's journey in their lives and the blessings found on that journey because of fear. You miss out on what God has in store for you in life because of fear. God had to bring punishment on them. And look what happens in Numbers 14, verses 1 through 3. "That night, all the members of the community raised their voices and wept aloud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron. And the whole assembly said to them, 'If only we had died in Egypt or in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? our wives and our children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? Fear defeated the Israelites. They failed to trust God and His plan and His purpose for them. They became discouraged and doubted instead of trusting God. Christians, we are there sometimes in our lives. We know what we should do. We understand what God wants us to do. But because of fear, we do not do it. And it happens to us at all ages. Children can be frozen in fear. Youth can be frozen in fear. Adults certainly can be frozen in fear. And because of their fear that they had, it caused them to disobey God. And because of that, that generation was not allowed to enter into the promised land. God said, you're going to continue in the wilderness. And for 40 years, they remained in the wilderness until that generation died off. God said, none of you will enter into the promised land. Only Joshua and Caleb was allowed to enter from that generation. And then Joshua and Caleb led the younger generation into the promised land. How can we stop fear from becoming, but from keeping us from obeying God? How can we put an end to fear? We're all going to experience fear. Fear is a part of being human. It's going to happen. And so many times we're willing to settle where we are, to just let things happen and continue the way they're going. But we can't do that as Christians. We have to step up and overcome fear in our lives. And let me give you four things that you can do when fear comes into your life. First, and the very, very first thing you should do is confess your fear to God. For those of you in here that have gone to the doctor and you've been told that you have a very bad disease, and there are a lot of you in here that have faced that, from cancer to heart problems to lung problems, you name it, you have faced that. And that fear grips you. The first thing I pray that most of you did was to confess your fear to God. Lord, I am scared to death right now with what the doctor has just told me. I am scared to death, but I'm going to trust you. Psalm 34:4, David is at that point of fear in his life. Think of all the things that happened bad to David over his life. And here's what he says in Psalm 34:4. I sought the Lord. He sought the Lord. He went to Him first. And He answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. That's what we have to do. When fear comes at us, confess it to God and trust Him to take you out of those fears. Secondly, we need to claim God's promises of protection. There are several promises in God's Word how He is going to protect us. But one of the most beautiful promises is Isaiah 41:10. He says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Listen, we are living in a world that has gone crazy. We're living in a world where Satan is having a field day. And if we're not careful, we can let that bring fear into our lives. Fear to do anything in our lives. There are actually people in Sumter, South Carolina today that hate to even go out of their homes to go to the grocery store or anywhere because of fear. And that's in cities across our nation that this is happening. Some of our members recently experienced Seattle, Washington, and they saw how crazy things are happening in Seattle. And that's repeated time and time again. And many people are frozen in fear. But we can't do that. As Christians, we have got to claim the promises of God's protection. When you face something serious in your life, when you face a fear that you just feel like you cannot overcome, First thing you have to do is confess it to God, and then you have to claim His promises of protection in your life. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And the good news is that God means what He says. He is going to be there for you. He is going to strengthen you. He is going to take care of you. The third thing you need to do is to continue to grow in your relationship with God. Your walk with God begins when you accept Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. And from that point on, it is a pilgrimage of growing in Him through Jesus Christ. We do not stop growing in our faith. If you do, then fear will overcome you. Fear will keep you from moving forward in God's will in your life. But the closer you get to God, the more you're willing to do and go the direction that God wants you to go. And you trust Him more and more as you grow in your relationship with Him. Many verses in the Bible tell us about growing in our relationship with Christ. In 1 John 4:18, it says, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love." You see, the more you learn to love God, the more you learn to walk in His relationship with you, the more you overcome fear in your life. That fear is covered by God's perfect love. God let me know absolutely and for sure in my life when I was in the 11th grade that He wanted me to go in the ministry. But because of fear, I did not tell very many people that. I did not let people know until my junior year in college. It took me that long to grow in my walk with God, to trust Him enough to be able to let others know that God wanted me to go into the ministry. And I'm so glad I finally reached that point. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline." We can overcome fear in our relationship with God through the power that He gives us. His power will give us the strength to overcome fear. In my life personally, there are many things, and I've told you this before, why I should not be standing in this pulpit today if I'd given in to fear. First of all, from the family that I was born into. My mom and dad didn't go to church, and I've told y'all that before. So as a child, I didn't go to church until a neighbor loved us enough to come and ask mom to let us go to church with her. I stuttered really, really bad all the way into the first grade. But God blessed me with a teacher that helped me overcome my stuttering for the most part. My tongue still gets tied sometimes, but for the most part, God took care of that through Mrs. Swift. She was a very patient and loving teacher that helped me through that in the first grade. Then I had the fear of being a redneck from the South. And I'll just tell you that. That's why I grew up a redneck in the South. And when God called me into the ministry, I said, "Lord, you don't need a redneck in the ministry. You don't need someone who has the dialect that I do, that has the twang to his voice that I do. You can't use me, Lord." And I fought every way I could to keep from doing it. But I overcame those fears through God's love for me, through His power in me. He gave me the ability to overcome those fears. And again, I am so thankful He did. For 40 plus years of ministry now, God has blessed me. And He has given me the strength over and over again when fear comes into my life. I do not want you as a Christian to live in fear. Where are you when it comes to fear in your life right now? Is there some fear that is gripping you? Are you like the 10 spies who wanted to abandon God's plan because of their fear? You're ready to give up on God's plan and to turn back. Or are you like Caleb and Joshua and say, "This is a land flowing with milk and honey. God promised it to us, and He's going to give it to us. And they move forward without fear. Please, don't let fear rob you of the blessings of God. God has a plan for each and every one of us. He has a plan for you. And in that plan, He has so many blessings He wants you to experience in life. But if you're not willing to overcome the fear of following God and moving forward in faith, you're not going to receive those blessings. You will not receive all of the great things that God has for you to experience here on this earth. And I don't want that for any of you, and neither does God. You see, God created you for a purpose. And in that purpose, as you follow His will, the blessings are going to be yours. The Bible says that they'll be overflowing in your life. But the devil has placed that ugly thing called fear in our lives. And that fear keeps us from doing what God wants us to do in our lives. That fear keeps us from experiencing the promised land. It's sad that that generation had to die off before they went into the promised land. It's sad that they missed out on the blessing that God had waiting for them to enter into that land that was so abundant and so full of blessings. I would pray today, if there is a fear in your life, won't you trust God? First go to Him and confess that fear. Then look at His promises and claim those promises in your life. And then trust Him and go the direction that He would have you to go in your life. As we come to our invitation this morning, there's some of you in here this morning that God's been dealing with you. You have not accepted His Son as your Savior and Lord yet. You're afraid to do it. You're afraid of what your friends will say. You're afraid of what others might think. You're afraid that you're going to have to give up things in life if you accept Jesus as Savior and Lord. Let me tell you, that is the devil putting that fear in your life to keep you from experiencing the greatest blessing of all. And that is the blessing of being saved through the power of the blood of Jesus Christ when He died on the cross for you. Your sins can be forgiven and you can become a child of God to live eternally with Him when you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. Oh, let God right now overcome that fear for you in your life and you claim Jesus today as your Savior and Lord. And for Christians that are here this morning, don't let God rob you of the blessings. Don't let the devil rob you of the blessings that God has for you. Don't let fear keep you from what God has waiting for you in your life. There are blessings in store for each and every one of us if we will not let fear keep us from doing what God would have us to do. As we come to our invitation this morning, you can come and kneel and pray, and you can lay your fears here on the altar and let God overcome those fears for you in your life. You can come and I'll be glad to pray with you. If you would want to accept Christ as your Savior and Lord, I will lead you in the sinner's prayer. Whatever your choice is this morning, if you feel God dealing with you, if there is fear that is holding you back in anything, won't you trust that to God? Would you join me as we pray? Heavenly Father, I thank You this morning for showing us how we can overcome fear. Showing us, Lord, that it's through You that fear can be defeated. As we confess it to You, as we grow closer to You in our relationship with You, as we trust Your promises of protection, we can see You work in our lives to give us the strength, to give us the power, to give us the courage to overcome that fear. Lord, I know because it's human nature that there are some here this morning that are frozen in fear. They won't move forward in their lives in the direction You want them to because they're afraid of what's down the road. They can't see it, so they're afraid of it. Lord, I would pray that they would this morning confess that fear to You. And Father, they would trust Your promises. Lord, I also pray for those who do not know Jesus as Savior and Lord this morning. And I know the fear that the devil has placed in their hearts. The fear of having to admit that they are a sinner. The fear of having to possibly lose friends because they get saved. The fear, Lord, of not knowing what it's like to be your child. Lord, may they overcome that fear this morning through the leading of the Holy Spirit, and may they accept Christ as their Savior and Lord. Father, today, may we leave our fears here at this altar or here in this room and walk out in your strength and your power into the world. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.